Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Adam Tickell, the Vice-Chancellor of the University now, and it's a huge honour and a moment of some nervousness speaking this afternoon in celebration of the life of such a wonderful and amazing contributor to the life of our university. I'd like to thank everybody here. What an amazing turnout this afternoon. I'd like to thank you all for joining us today to celebrate the life of one of the most distinguished academics of the 20th century, and of course somebody who has had such an amazing role in creating this great university, Lord Asa Briggs. Asa, as he will be known to most of you. And I'd like to give my particularly warm welcome to Lady Briggs and members of her family for joining us on this really important event for Sussex. Asa Briggs was, as you all know, unquestionably one of Britain's most distinguished historians. But of course, he had a wide range of interests outside of his really distinguished contribution to his discipline. In an era of specialists, he was a true polymath. He was a prolific writer, and I was talking to Susan last week, and she said that he was writing until the very last moment. And he continued to publish even as late as last year. He was publishing and making an outstanding contribution to the life and the cultural life of our country. His numerous publications are well known to everybody, but include 5 volumes of his history of broadcasting in the UK, his seminal Victorian Things, Victorian People, and Social History of England, which covers a small period of British history from the Stone Age to the premiership of Margaret Thatcher. He was, of course, one of the founding fathers of our university, and his impact and influence on our university simply cannot be overestimated. He was the first professor of history, the founding Dean of Social Studies, and one of the very first appointments made by our first Vice-Chancellor, John Fulton. As of course everybody knows, he became our second Vice-Chancellor in 1967 and steered Sussex through its bloom of growth and the heady days from the late 1960s until the mid-1970s. And I have to say, as Alistair Smith is here today, and unfortunately none of the other successors could be here today. But as everybody will testify, he is an exceptionally and probably uniquely hard act to follow. At Sussex, he created a new university for the 20th century. And his famous phrase, "A new map of learning for higher education," paved the way for the university for the successive period. This was and remains a pioneering and distinctive university. And I'm absolutely determined to make sure that I can build upon and develop this great legacy. After he left us, he returned to Oxford to become Provost of Worcester College and had distinguished associations with universities of Leeds, University of Chicago, and of course played a foundational role in creating that other great institution, the Open University, where he was Chancellor from 1978 to 1994. Despite this list of associations with numerous institutions, both within the university sector and without, during his lifetime, it's clear that Asa had a very special place in his heart for Sussex. And I think it's abundantly clear from the range of people here today and the distances from which people have travelled that he touched the hearts of many people, staff and students who he came into contact with whilst he was here. I am quite genuinely delighted, and I have to say humbled, that a few of his former students and colleagues will be sharing their memories of Asa with us today. Nobody will be better placed to convey his impact and legacy on Sussex than they and you indeed will be. One of these is Tom Chemnitz, who I met earlier. Tom's travelled from New York, travelled on Monday to join us today to celebrate ACE's life. On behalf of the university and also on behalf of the Briggs family, I just would like to give my special thanks to Tom, both for coming and for an extraordinarily generous pledge to endow a programme of PhD scholarships in ACE's name. Tom, thank you so much. And these will be PhD scholarships in British history, and again, what could be more apt. I know that ACE himself was very touched by this generosity, and for me that speaks volumes about how this great man was able to inspire people throughout his life. I'd also like to thank Lady Briggs, Susan, for allowing us to direct all donations in memory of ACE towards the ACE Briggs Scholarships Fund. And this was launched by the university on his 80th birthday. He was an overachiever, 18th would have been a little bit early. If you would like to contribute, then there are details to be found in the programme on that. On a personal note, it's a matter of real regret and some sadness to me that I didn't have the opportunity to meet ACE in person. I long admired him as an academic, and as I was going through the journey to become Vice-Chancellor, I obviously got to learn a huge amount about how he had contributed to our life. But as I said at the beginning, I am genuinely honoured and humbled to follow in the footsteps of such a visionary man. And I'd like to finish by reminding us all that we remain indebted to him for making Sussex such a special place. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I'm Chris McDermott, the lead chaplain at the University of Sussex, and on behalf of the meeting house and on behalf of the chaplaincy team here at the university, I want to welcome all of you, the Briggs family, and all guests who have come here to join us in honoring ACE Briggs' memory. This service will very much be along the lines of honoring and celebrating ACE's contribution to this place and to the lives of many who are gathered here for this service. Services have already been held in different parts of the country over the past year, coming out of ACE's vast connections and networks. But this service will very much revolve around ACE's contribution and legacy here at the University of Sussex. So it will be a great honor to have former colleagues, former students, and others sharing in this event. In a moment, we will begin the service proper, and I just want to say the service will just roll according to the program that you have in hand without any further comment from me until the end. But on a practical note, especially for speakers and singer and readers, the acoustics in this building are quite wonderful when it comes to singing and music. But the acoustics here are the absolute nemesis to the human voice. So readers and speakers especially, just to let you know, there are some devices on this desk that are recording your every word, so please don't stamp the desk in excitement as you speak. Declaim directly into the microphone, and please do speak slowly, even to the point of thinking you're patronizing us. Please patronize us. We want to hear every word you read and every word you say. So with that in mind, I now invite Daniel Briggs to come forward and begin the service with a reading.
Before the Old Testament reading, which comes from the book of Proverbs, I'd like first to make a brief reference to the book of Chronicles. Here, we find Asa's namesake. He was a king of Judah and a great-grandson of King Solomon, to whom the book of Proverbs is attributed. The book of Chronicles tells us, "And Asa did that which was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. And the heart of Asa was wholly true all his days." Turning to today's reading, this comes from the 8th book of Proverbs. "Doth not wisdom cry, and understanding put forth her voice? She standeth in the top of high places, by the way, in the places of the paths. She crieth at the gates, at the entry of the city, at the coming in at the doors. Unto you, O men, I call, and my voice is to the sons of man. Receive my instruction, and not silver, and knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things that may be desired are not to be compared to it. I, wisdom, dwell with prudence, and find out knowledge of witty inventions. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogancy, and the evil way, and the froward mouth do I hate. Counsel is mine, and sound wisdom. I am understanding, I have strength. By me kings reign, and princes decree justice. By me princes rule, and nobles, even all the judges of the earth. I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. Riches and honor are with me, yea, durable riches and righteousness. My fruit is better than gold, yea, than fine gold, and my revenue than choice silver. I lead in the way of righteousness in the midst of the paths of judgment, that I may cause those that love me to inherit substance, and I will fill their treasures." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Asa was quite simply the most remarkable, inspiring, and gifted man I've ever worked with. When I first read the draft, my first draft of this tribute, it took me over 20 minutes. This is a heavily edited version as I concentrate on the University of Sussex in Asa's life. It omits his scholarship, it omits the decades he spent on European university management and strategy, working with three of his early days team at Sussex, Howell Jones, who by then was Mr. Higher Education in the European Commission, Ed Prosser, and myself. It omits the Vice-Chancellorship of the Open University, where again he was united with two of that team, Joe Clinch and Ellie Milburn. It omits his work for the Workers' Education Association, and much more. I first met Asa in April 1961, a few months before the formal foundation of the university, and worked with him in varying degrees for 40 years. However, Asa's involvement with the University of Sussex predates that of any other founder of the institution. In the 1950s, in his 30s, he was a member of the National University Grants Committee. On that committee, he successfully advocated the creation of new universities. And I have no doubt that his relations with the officers of that committee were instrumental in the first pioneering university being here in Sussex. When John Fulton was appointed as the principal of the university in 1959, he badgered Asa for months to join him at Sussex. In the end, Asa agreed, after a nudge from Susan. Not the last of the nudges from Susan to benefit the University of Sussex. The partnership of John Fulton and Asa Briggs, which I witnessed over those first few years of the university, was a model of cooperation and tact. Two men of different ages, different characters, different social environments, combining to create a new institution. Clearly, they shared a lot of decision-taking, but basically, John concentrated on the building of the campus and achieving the 3,000 student target as quickly as possible. Whereas Asa concentrated on the academic side, the new maps of learning, interdisciplinarity, and the concept of the schools of studies. But in that capacity, Asa was also the person primarily responsible for the recruitment, not only of the founding academic fathers, but of the next wave of younger faculty. When Asa took over the Vice-Chancellorship, he not unsurprisingly demonstrated that he was not just a great scholar. His organizational skills and his people management skills were excellent. And moreover, Asa, more than any other Vice-Chancellor I've known, had studied the Vice-Chancellorship as an office. He saw its complexities. There are two main dimensions to that office. One is, as chairman of Senate, he or she is the academic leader, the first amongst equals in the collegium. But secondly, he or she is the chief executive of the lay governing body, the council, and in that capacity has a much more business role. Both those dimensions require different modes and styles of decision-making and relationship. Asa was excellent at both those and their combination. As Vice-Chancellor, Asa concentrated on the strategic and the current hotspots in decision-taking. Relying on the academic and admin teams he'd built up to carry forward the management and admin agendas. Others today will talk about Asa's academic side, so I'd just like to make one comment. One example of Asa's restless energy and creativity. In the late 1960s, the academic team opted for a period of consolidation after the rapid expansion of the 1960s. ASA reluctantly accepted that, but then moved on to new creations. In the next 3 or 4 years, he created about 10 independent, interdisciplinary research institutes on the model of SPRU. In the chief executive role, ASA was equally creative. He set up a vice-chancellor's office consisting of 4 young but experienced professional staff who, working with the pro-vice-chancellor, Sir Michael Thompson as he now is, had the task of coordinating the administration and influencing its direction, but of doing the detailed work on the forward strategic plans of the university. I think ASA, in his work at Bletchley Park, had seen the value of disciplined interdisciplinary teams focusing on clear objectives. But working with him daily in those years, we witnessed the magic of the man, the fantastic memory, the crucial eye for detail, the people management, the vision, the political perceptions. He was an all-round expert. But ASA always treated people as equals. Whether or not he thought them as such, he always treated them as equals. In the latter years of his vice-chancellorship, we exported that VC's office concept across the whole administration, and he created an integrated generalist professional internal civil service to support the administrative and business and academic work of the university. The fact that that service lasted until 1996, 20 years after his departure, is yet another tribute to the depth and length of ASA's impact upon the University of Sussex. Another of ASA's strengths was the usage of his global reputation in the external relations field to put the new University of Sussex on the map across the continents and locally. Locally, he embedded himself in the local community, in the Sussex community. He was also creative in this role. For example, in the mid-1960s, he and John Fulton offered the Brighton Technical College the right to award degrees of the University of Sussex on its own terms. If that offer had been accepted, the pattern of higher education in Sussex today would be very different and much better. ASA cherished students and ensured that they had a strong role in the governance of the university. And that wasn't tokenism. For example, despite the open opposition of the Bursar's office, ASA insisted that council grant the lead role on the design and development of Park Village on the East Slope to the Students' Union, something which had not been done in any other university. He had warm relations with all student leaders, regardless of their politics. When the Vietnam War wave of student troubles hit the universities, ASA addressed and debated with the mass body of the students. He had the determination, the courage to go and face the whole mass of students and debate openly with them the issues involved. Later, he showed his humanity and compassion as well. When he readmitted the student who'd been expelled permanently for his part in the red paint incident quietly to the university. As I said earlier, I could go on and on about ASA, but I will leave it at that. I'll simply conclude by saying that much though I admire John Fulton, ASA is the giant in the creation and development of the University of Sussex.
I originally came to Sussex in the spring of 1962 as an occasional student, the first American at Sussex, and for the first year, the only American at Sussex. And then I came back in 1964 as a doctoral student of ASA's, and I stayed for 5 years before I got my degree. My choice was to spend 5 years at Sussex, or 3 years at Sussex and 2 years in Vietnam. And it didn't seem a difficult choice to make. You know, I'm sure Brighton is much nicer than Saigon. And in those 5 years, I was ASA's student. In the last years, he had me in an office that was next to his, when he was Vice-Chancellor. And everything that happened in his office was perfectly audible to me through a flimsy door. And what astonished me most about ASA was his huge institutional tolerance for people who personally frustrated him. You know, ASA, of course, wanted to use every moment of his life productively. And there were people who didn't seem to get Sussex so well as part of the faculty, and they took time that ASA begrudged. And from time to time, this staccato burst of yes, yes, yes would come rattling through the door. And I knew that Asa was being frustrated. And occasionally, at the end of the day, when a glass of sherry wouldn't do, he would suggest that we take a walk around the perimeter of the campus. And there, well out of earshot of anybody who mattered, he would vent his frustration about X or Y. And one evening I asked him why he didn't suggest to X that he might find a better fit at a more traditional university. And Asa's response was that would be a profound mistake. That would be the wrong thing to do, that in order to be a great university, Sussex had to tolerate everyone, had to not only tolerate them, but welcome them. As long as these people were productive, it mattered greatly that they were kept and embraced, no matter how ill the fit seemed. And years later, of course, when he was no longer constrained by the Official Secrets Act, he said that this is what he learned at Bletchley Park, that Bletchley Park only worked because they embraced everyone who could be productive, and that the Germans never could have run a Bletchley Park because they were so intolerant. But that greatness and success depended upon this tolerance. And of course, the corollary of this tolerance was his vision, the new map of learning. And we're probably going to hear about the new map of learning from every speaker. But it made it hardwired into the university the demand for the tolerance, that people couldn't just confine themselves to departments, that they had to get along, they had to hear one another, they had to tolerate one another and respect one another and work with one another. And this was what was so vital to Sussex and to making Sussex and a Sussex education special. And the enormous value of the interdisciplinary education is the primary pedagogic insight I gained at Sussex. And it has formed and informed the rest of my life. I spent the last 40 years developing curricula and textbooks that have the Sussex vision built into them, and that seem to be about one subject, but actually have many subjects hidden in there. It has made our textbooks distinctive and our curricula highly prized. Millions of American children have had the advantage of Sussex interdisciplinary approach in their classroom or homeschool textbooks. And now, as I build an online school for American homeschool children, I find myself once again unfolding the new map of learning and following its path. In fact, I left Sussex in the autumn of 1969, but I've spent the rest of my life trying to recreate the Sussex experience that Asa shaped, and my gratitude to him could not be greater.
Susan, Briggs family, friends, words. If anybody can be called a weaver of words, it was surely Asa. When he was 90, the university held an event here at which he told us that he was still writing at least 1,000 words a day. He also told us at that same event that as a schoolboy, it was a toss-up when he was going to go to Cambridge as to whether he would do history or science. And that interdisciplinarity that has just been spoken about was what attracted many of us to come here, as I did in 1967. And so in a tribute to that interdisciplinarity, I've attempted to mix art and science, or at least technology, by making on my Mac computer a word cloud. Now, you will know, of course, that a word cloud is a graphic in which the words that appear most frequently in a text appear larger, and those that appear less frequently appear smaller. And here are just a very few of the words that come to my mind when I think about Asa. And I'm thinking about him for the purposes of today as I perceived him and knew him as a student in 1967 to 71. I should say I was never his academic student. I knew him because of my devotion to the activities of the Students' Union. So devoted was I that I have still a memo from one of my tutors who said to me, "Would you mind coming at least once to a seminar this term if you could tear yourself away from the office?" In 1967, I was the first of the new large intake. The university suddenly expanded to a whole 3,000 people. And we were divided up, I think it was A to K and L to Z. And we went to one of the lecture theatres on the first or second day here, and we were addressed by Asa. And immediately one saw that he was a communicator, that he was a visionary, that he was a teacher. I came to know him, as I say, not as an academic teacher, but nevertheless, I learned an enormous amount from him. I learned by seeing him in action, for example, with the Senate, seeing him in action with our students. I came to see his skill, his political skill. I came to see his wisdom. He was easy to talk to. I think it was partly because he actually liked students, and that doesn't actually apply to all teachers necessarily. About 5 years ago, we made a film to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the university, and I interviewed Asa, and he said at that point, talking about the troubles, the les événements of 1968, the troubles of 68 to 71, he said, "My sympathies were always with people who were prepared to stand up for what was right." He said people were at the university, and if they couldn't really say what they felt at university, then there was something wrong with what universities were. And then he added, "I should say there were quite a lot of people in the faculty at that time at Sussex who didn't agree with me." He was enormously hospitable, another word on my list. One of the great joys of knowing Asa as a consequence was being able to go to Ashcombe House, which meant that one met the family. Susan, first of all, who seemed to cope with the influx of student executives or even protesters on the lawn with great equanimity, and to meet Daniel and Catherine, Judith and Matthew. And to keep those relationships since then has been one of the great pleasures of my life. At one time, I do remember, and Daniel no doubt will recall, that my sister, who was also at Sussex after me, and I invited him up to Granada Television to see if that's how he thought his life should go. We gave him, as I think they say, a good time. It's quite hard to remember quite a lot of it. But quite wisely, he decided to go into the city instead. And it has been a great thrill for me since we've just made another film about the great changes that are happening on the campus over the next few years, that it was edited by Matthew, who is a most accomplished professional film editor. And it was fantastic to work together, not least because I remember him when he was three. Convivial, a conversationalist. Mrs. Gandhi came to London in the 70s and apparently requested that she should be able to meet at Downing Street some British intellectuals. This threw Whitehall into total confusion. But a group of people was gathered together, and naturally, Asa was amongst them. And he told me afterwards, with absolute astonishment and horror, really, that Indira Gandhi had absolutely no small talk. He was fantastically energetic. He exuded energy. He made you feel that anything was possible. The whole place, when I was here, seemed suffused with this energy. Another word on my list, it's a rather nasty little neologism, actually, but it applies, I think, very well, and that's multitasker. I think Asa was the first multitasker I ever met. There used to be a joke in the union office, but if you wanted to talk to him for any length of time, the thing to do was to find out from Eleanor Milburn, his PA, when he was getting a train to London, to buy a ticket for that train, to find him, and then you could talk to him while he simultaneously corrected the proofs for his BBC history, looked at, no doubt, one of Tom's dissertations, and went through the papers for the next Senate meeting. We could discuss squatters in Farmer House, we could discuss anything. He was always approachable. But, as you all remember who knew him, you had to keep up, because he didn't hang around and wait for you to catch up with him. 2 or 3 years after he left the university, he was at Oxford, and I was working nearby, and I stayed for one night at the provost lodgings, and I was his guest at High Table, which was about the nearest I was ever going to get to an Oxford college. We had a drink beforehand in the senior common room, and then we set off at a gallop to the dining hall, and we charged up to High Table. All the way, he was giving me a running commentary on the people I was going to be sitting near, so-and-so who knew Steve Biko, somebody who knew something else. And just as we got to the table, he said to me, "And sitting opposite you, and I think you'll find him extremely interesting, is Wooler." He was gone. So we sat down and we started to talk. I spoke to the people next to me. Then I started to speak to this chap opposite, who I didn't know. And it became apparent that he was talking about editions of Handel, the composer. And he said, it's extraordinary. He said, "There are no good new editions of Messiah." And I said, "But what about the Watkins Shaw Messiah?" And he said, "I'm Watkins Shaw." Funnily enough, the last time I was in this meeting house, I think, was when I sang Messiah, when we used to do the scratch Messiahs just before Christmas, when Laszlo Heltai was the music director here. In the Sopranos' first entry, it's a recit in which the angel appears to the shepherds. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not." As you know, the motto of the university is "Be still and know," which some wag once said should be translated as "Shut up and listen." But sometimes I think perhaps "Fear not" would have been a better motto, because the greatest gift that I think Asa gave to his students was not to fear. It was not to be afraid to speak truth to power. It was not to be afraid to go out into the world. At the end of the interview that I did with him 5 years ago, he said of the university, "Sussex will benefit most in the future if it is not afraid to be itself." God bless you, Asa.
I didn't know until last year that Asa wrote poetry, and I think a lot of people didn't realize the extent to which he loved poetry. And the first poem that I ever heard of his was at his funeral in Lewes over a year ago. And Susan has chosen this poem for today, and we were talking last night on the phone, and she told me that Asa's first poem appeared in his school magazine. So he was writing consistently from a boy, really, right up until the end. His penultimate poem, she told me, was one written for their diamond, on the occasion of their diamond anniversary, and featured the diamond ring that he had given you, I think you said. This poem was also written towards the end of Asa's life. It was written at Seaford on August the 12th, 2015, so within the last year, 7 months before he died. It's very Acer-ish. I can't use another word. It's extremely personal. It's got humor, imagination, and a constant sense of questing. And I hope you enjoy it. It's an immense privilege to be reading it. It's in two sections. The first is called Our Island. Our Island. I circumnavigate this island early in the morning, 3 times a week, following my way in words, not water. I listen to the weather forecast, most carefully to the voices of the readers of it, some delight to hear. From point to point, I travel with them, covering the outer islands too, Faroes and Shetlands, the Isle of Wight, the Scilly Isles, the Isle of Man, and all the Hebrides, inner and outer. They drift in and out of sight in no particular order. I pause when we arrive at the Mull of Galloway, far longer than they do. I knew it as a schoolboy. I learned to swim there in the Solway Firth, long before Sellafield. Walter Scott's Guy Mannering was read to us. Learning the times of every train, I read my Dorothy Sayers by myself. Far to the north, one of the places I have never seen, nor will, is blessed with a name I never will forget. I love the way the forecasters pronounce it, Cape Wrath, always with an A as flat as that in Bradford. Our planet. Nothing is local now. Our world we call a globe. Our most used adjective is global. It can carry a range of human warnings. And yet, in planetary terms, our planet is so small, it seems that it is lost in space. I learned that as a boy from Eddington, grown up from watching the films of Star Trek. There are so many questions easier to ask than answer. How did our world begin, evolve? Is there some form of life in outer space? We talked of Martians once as our invaders before our cameras invaded Mars. Now they range over galaxies far outside our own, seeking Earth too. My meditation ends in speculation. And all the speculation starts with how. There is one very big one. What is our life, and how did it come to be? Bless you, Asa.
Thank you. Miss Heaney was a friend of Asa and Susan's during their time at Oxford. Asa and Susan had the great gift of friendship, and this was published posthumously by Seamus Heaney's publishers. Anchises, fatherly and intent, was off in a deep green valley, surveying and reviewing souls consigned there, those due to pass to the light of the upper world. It so happened, he was just then taking note of his whole posterity, the destinies and doings, traits and qualities of descendants dear to him. But seeing Aeneas come wading through the grass towards him, he reached his two hands out in eager joy. His eyes filled up with tears, and he gave a cry, "At last! Are you here at last? I always trusted that your sense of right would prevail and keep you going to the end. And am I now allowed to see your face, my son, and hear you talk, and talk to you myself? This is what I imagined and looked forward to as I counted the days, and my trust was not misplaced. To think of the lands and the outlying seas you've crossed, my son, to receive this welcome. And after such dangers, I was afraid that Africa might be your undoing." But Aeneas replied, "Often and often, father, you would appear to me. Your sad shade would appear, and that kept me going to this end. Let me take your hand, my father. Oh, let me, and do not hold back from my embrace." And as he spoke, he wept. Three times he tried to reach arms round that neck. Three times the form reached for in vain escaped like a breeze between his hands, a dream on wings.
Interviewed for an assistant lectureship in modern European history by Asa and Morris Hutt in the middle of that very cold winter of 1962, to was three. The campus was still largely bare and frozen solid. It was very difficult to foresee what the future would hold for this experiment in redrawing the map of learning. My memory of the interview was that it was very short. I was also to teach modern Russian history and to start a degree in Russian studies. Language and literature already existed. Asa made up his mind about things and people very quickly. He also took risks. I was very young, very inexperienced, and had no qualifications whatsoever in either Russian or Russian history. I spent the first 6 months trying to pretend that I was at least 30 and knew what I was doing. Asa, of course, was famous for being able to do four things at once. As for the rest of us, it was said that given a fortnight's notice, we could learn to teach anything, and most of us did. It was enormous fun and very exhausting, especially if, like me, you had a background in London University with its firm one-discipline approach to learning. I think that early generation will always be grateful for the opportunity to share in an experiment in learning and teaching to which we became very committed. I want to read you two brief extracts from Asa's chapter in the idea of a new university, which will give you some idea of what he had in mind. The basic pattern was clear enough. The familiar antithesis between specialized and general education was rejected. Both specialization and general education were seen as a central part of a balanced university education. An undergraduate would be expected not to study a multitude of unrelated subjects side by side, or one after the other, but continuously to relate his specialized study to impinging and overlapping studies. Thereby, it was felt he would become not only an educated person, but potentially at least a better specialist. He would know about the hearings of his specialism as well as about its content. The contextual studies which would be common to different specialists in particular schools would always include a critical evaluation of concepts and procedures, preferably comparatively, an examination of historical perspectives, and an exploration of contemporary issues and problems. Being explorers ourselves in a new university, explorers with ample maps of other universities, but none of our own, we wanted to make our students into explorers also, to encourage them to find relations between subjects where we did not see them ourselves, and to dispute some of our own conceptions. Given the huge changes which are taking place, both in the formulation of new knowledge and in the world of action where the knowledge is being applied, we did not want to be confined to our own original territory, even though the boundaries were within it were being knocked down. We recognized that we would also have to move into outer space. And move into outer space we did, and we took our students with us. It was quite a journey, and I will always be deeply grateful to Asa for letting me be part of it.
Dear Susan and family, colleagues and friends, I'm calling my tribute to Asa by the simple term already used many times, making history. All of us know that the new University of Sussex made educational history. So did the Open University. But as yet, no one, to my knowledge, has written a book called The Age of Sussex, or The Age of the Open University. Instead, we have an evocative, studious, and scholarly book called The Age of Asa, published in November 2014. The title is a poetic piece of alliteration, all those lovely alpha A's. It cleverly reflects the fact that it was a gift to Asa and the kind of festschrift which requires a name, and a first name to boot, just as Asa had introduced first names to the Leeds Department of History all those years ago. Seeing the title, we could enjoy the fact that Asa had written the classic Age of Improvement, and it was perfect to choose a title which would enable us to equate the person Asa with the word improvement. Age of Asa, Age of Improvement. They both inform each other. They are interchangeable. Asa was an outstanding historian. Still more, he was, as many have now said, a maker of history. He made, or at the very least helped to make, an era we all recognize and have benefited from. I arrived to teach French history at Sussex in 1962, along with a co-graduate early modern historian, Peter Burke. We had met Asa in 1961 in a couple of Oxford pubs. And when Peter was in touch recently, he finished his letter by saying, "I'm sure I don't need to remind you that our informal encounters with Asa Briggs in 1961 have certainly changed our lives." Today, this is a very moving and important memorial event. It's one of deep personal and collective acknowledgement and gratitude. At the front of Worcester College, there were iron railings, presumably restored after losing them to the war economy, railings to which everyone padlocked their bicycles. One day, so the student story runs, a well-known college don was laboriously pumping up his back bicycle tire, even though it was clearly the front tire that was flat. An amused crowd of students formed, and eventually someone pointed out to the venerated academic that he'd got the wrong tire. He stood up, wiped his forehead, and said, "Don't they communicate?" Later, when I'd been at Sussex for a while, the joke was still circulating, but it had a sequel. "No, they don't, sir," said the same voice from the crowd, wishing to be helpful. The don was now fully involved. "Why not?" he replied. It wasn't Asa. But in Asa's world, that was the question to ask. Communication was a dominant theme of his leadership. How things, people, events, ideas related to each other and could be made to communicate. If they didn't, why not? We knew this long before he wrote his groundbreaking volumes on the BBC, and a very long time before we knew of his work at Bletchley. Communication informed his love of travel and talking to audiences across the world. It informed his way of dealing with the protests of students and recalcitrant colleagues, and his way of bringing arts and science together. An early Sussex exhibition in 1965 was called Art in Science, Science in Art. The New Scientist, to which Azo was a contributor, reviewed it well. Communication meant new perspectives and problem solving. Hugh Carney acknowledged this when he entitled the first series of history books to come out of Sussex, Problems and Perspectives in History. This was Azo speak. It was communication as discovery, but it was also the way Azo enabled people to pursue their own skills and their own interests. He was never dogmatic. There was never an ideology to which people had to conform. He valued new connections, which came from a vast variety of sources. I remember a discussion with Azo and the architect Basil Spence about place and context, at which Spence talked of the elusive nature of the campus building. Falmer House and Vespasian's Colosseum, the bastion rounds of the Arts Centre and Pevensey Castle, the Parthenon position of the library, and eventually the honeycombed echo of Clytemnestra's tomb and a Wealden Oast house in this very building, the meeting house. Links across time and place. Very Spence, very Azo, global, European, local. A few years later, the enthusiasm of Angus Calder, a Sussex alumnus, to bring Tom Harrison's mass observation archive to Sussex raised some questions in the media, asking, why not Manchester or Bolton or any industrial heartland? Why Sussex? The world of Azo was the link. In the words of Margareta Jolly and Fiona Courage, he recognized mass observation's poetic form of science as something which knew no territorial boundaries. Place could be contextualized. Hadn't he done this already? A Yorkshire-born, Cambridge, London, Oxford, and Leeds historian, he included Melbourne in Australia in his book on Victorian cities. Making history, new perspectives, new relationships. He remained all his life a patron of the National Life Stories, which is the archive of the British Library, as well as a patron of mass observation. Life stories to be heard and recorded. The question, whose history, to be asked. New horizons in adult and continuing education. Widening access to university through the early leavers scheme. Could anyone, then or now, talk about these things without homage to Azo? They all needed a wind of change. I sometimes thought of the Mappa Mundi that Azo was creating as having Azo at all four corners of the map, blowing the winds which would prevail. At the center of this map was not just communication. The age of Asia was and still is an age or a mindset of policy formation, policy in education and in science, in development studies and lifetime learning, and an astonishing range of public service. Policy formation, he insisted, needed research and enlightened vision, no less than history, broadcasting, social studies, nursing, or physics. The depth and range of Asa's world was prodigious. The teams which surrounded him were themselves inspiring. He had an unusual capacity to recognize and value the visionary leadership of others. He was a deeply prized personal friend and colleague. He made friends and devotees in all sections of society. He himself was enabled by Susan and all the family in equally prodigious ways. We celebrate them today. Wonderful memories. Ah, those radio times, to quote another book title, but this one by Susan herself, highly praised by Jean Seton. The personification of an age is risky, but in this case it seems so justified as anyone who knew Asa well. The tributes today and those of the last year make that very clear. The age of Asa is very much alive, fighting to keep its values at the forefront of policy. You could tell from the passionate sense of the past and the relevance in the present behind Tristram Hunt's archive hour dedicated to Asa on the BBC. You can explore Queen's Park Books in Brighton to discover the energy behind the animation of local history in Brighton, always associated with Asa and fellow historians of ordinary people's lives. The Asa Briggs history scholarships are there, reaching across the world and creating new connections. On a musical note, the Sussex Sounds of 60s, created by the Baskervilles and their subsequent reincarnations, can be heard on the Iceman CD. And on a personal note, Pete Wilby, who read history at Sussex in the mid-1960s, who was one of my students, did a profile yesterday in The Guardian of Helena Kennedy and her powerful dedication to further and furthering education, which brings both Pete himself and Asa firmly in mind. How can she be doing so many things at once? It was doubly the mystery of Asa. How was it possible? Maybe the current research at Sussex behind the first ever blueprint of a large-scale quantum computer can help us explain. It introduces the phenomenon of an atom which can be in two places at once. Was this Asa's secret? Quantum research is mind-bending. So too was Asa's life and his legacy. We owe him so much. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Sussex. Thank you, Susan and family. Thank you, Asa.
Please be seated for a few moments. As a part of our closing prayer, I invite you to spend a few moments in silence, recollecting our sense of Asa, our connections with Asa, our experience of him. And for those of us who did not have that personal connection, perhaps our sense of gratitude for
his legacy embodied here in this university. And now, gathering up all our thoughts and our prayers, I invite you to join me in saying together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Before the benediction, may I remind you that after this service, the Briggs family will be very pleased to greet and meet you downstairs in a reception held on the ground floor of this building. And now we pray God's blessing on this assembly. May our memories of Asa and our experience of him and all other people who have graced our lives over the years distill in us as goodness in this world. May all the people of this planet know peace and well-being. And as we leave this place, may we strive to be that change we want to see in our world. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Now go well and go in peace.